The reason this is so interesting is because skeuomorphism evolves. We don't really look at the trash can icon or the folder icon and see what we saw 5 to 10 years ago. Flat design has replaced sort of dimensional imagery with drop shadows and glares because it creates a simpler interface that's a lot easier to use. And because in a way, the functionality of skeuomorphism is now obsolete. We know what a trash can is going to do. We know what a folder is going to do. It doesn't need to look like a realistic depiction of one in order to inform us of its function. Hi, I'm Jen Spatz. I'm a recent graduate of RISD's Master of Industrial Design program. And I come from a background of art making and teaching art. I graduated from Cooper Union many years ago and went on to become an art teacher, where I taught students from grades K through 12 in New York City. And after about 7 years of that, I moved on to pursuing industrial design at RISD. And I'm here to talk about my thesis, which I guess I'd like to start by saying was not on a subject that I wanted it to be on originally. As I said, I come from a background of visual making. I identify with visual parts of the projects that I've worked on, and it seemed as though pursuing a year-long course of research and experimentation about non-visual digital communication was potentially not the best way to do the things that I'm good at and the things that I love. But I had a couple of itches, which is a term one of my teachers uses to talk about to describe the half-formed ideas that sort of breed thesis projects. So I had a couple of itches that I couldn't seem to let go of, and so I went with my gut, and I pursued this course of study about conversation design. Maybe I'll tell you about what those itches were as a way of sort of giving you a sense of why I went down this path, even though I didn't want to. And the first was that the year prior, I had spent a long time researching the crossover between accessibility and digital interfaces. I learned a lot about screen readers, which are the software that the blind and visually impaired use to navigate visual interfaces like mobile phones and desktop computers. And I had really become fascinated with this tool because while it does have a fair few design flaws, it provides an entirely auditory window into the digital experiences that we think of as exclusively visual. And in the course of my research, I learned that, you know, the ability to listen to this high-speed synthesized speech and these sounds and to make some sense of them wasn't some sort of superpower that the blind and visually impaired possess that a mainstream user doesn't, but rather like a muscle that they had developed. So I became fascinated with the fact that, you know, technically sighted computer users are capable of experiencing digital information through sound. And the second itch that I had was about skeuomorphism, which, if you're not familiar with the term, basically means the representation of real world objects, imagery and phenomena in a digital space, so as to familiarize a user that might feel ill-adjusted or unacquainted with that space. So like the skeuomorphs that most people are very familiar with are the icons that you would see on your desktop, like a folder representing a folder from the real world, or a trash can representing a trash can from the real world. And you know, there's been a little bit of talk recently about how voice user interface design is skeuomorphic, but in a completely different way. Instead of taking an image from the real world, it appropriates human-to-human conversation into a digital experience. And the reason this is so interesting is because skeuomorphism evolves. We don't really look at the trash can icon or the folder icon and see what we saw 5 to 10 years ago. flat design has replaced sort of dimensional imagery with drop shadows and glares because it creates a simpler interface that's a lot easier to use. And because in a way, the functionality of skeuomorphism is now obsolete. We know what a trash can is going to do. We know what a folder is going to do. It doesn't need to look like a realistic depiction of one in order to inform us of its function. And so inevitably, the skeuomorphism of conversation design will probably evolve also. And the question is, what happens? What happens when the sort of like flourish and residue of conversation, the way that we're used to experiencing it with people, is slimmed down to its bare minimum? How much can we take away from language and leave behind the meaning that we intend for it to have? And so I had these questions, and you know, I was recognizing that not a lot of other designers were looking at voice interface design the same way that I was. Most were relying on the principles of fairly traditional human-to-human conversation as sort of a guide for developing interactions. And so I wanted to question, what if we did it differently? What if we thought of it, you know, as a system of sounds and abbreviated words that we could interact with quickly? And I began to do a series of experiments and lead a series of observations that would inform the design of a sort of a prop for encouraging designers to think outside the box when it comes to voice interface design. So originally, I wanted to start with some observation, both of traditional conversation and of user experiences with voice interfaces as they exist now. And I have to say that some of my more boring experiments were the ones that I learned the most from. You know, I recorded conversations, I eavesdropped on them, I watched people use a drive-through window for a while. And what I began to see is that, you know, there's a lot of conversation that carries more than information. You know, there's gesture, there's laughter, there are pauses, there are sighs, and all of this can add context and nuance to the things that we're saying. And in some situations, that's valuable information that gives more meaning to the things that we're trying to say. But then in other cases, it's simply elongating the experience of asking a question or receiving an answer. For example, you know, when I set an alarm using Siri, I don't think that Siri really needs to know what kind of a mood I'm in to do that. So I thought that experience was very valuable in just assessing, like, really what is conversation and what are the parts of it that are strictly informational and what are the parts of it that are sort of, you know, human nature and about making eye contact with somebody and just appreciating their presence. And then I moved on to, I suppose, a series of visualizations. They were almost experiments, but really more so an attempt to showcase some of the ideas that I was thinking about to other people and to start conversations by showing them these videos. And some of the things I was thinking about in these videos were the standardization of sound. You know, we have icons that traditionally represent different interface functionalities, and in some cases all fall within the same tone. But sound doesn't really do this. You know, the nature of the way that a car horn sounds and the nature of the whoosh that you hear when you send an email away are completely different. You know, one is an artificial sound and the other comes from nature, you know, a page turning or a paper airplane flying through the air. And so, you know, for one of my experiments, I questioned whether or not all sounds could come from an environment that made them cohesive and what that would be like. And so it was a bizarre experiment where I took an enormous stack of paper and I just created every sound I could possibly think of with that paper. And that was just one of a series of different experiments and visualizations that I created. Well, first I'll say I was really surprised by how seriously people took my work when it seemed sort of whimsical and unusual. I was at first a little bit hesitant to show people videos of other students using their voices to make unusual sounds, using props to make sounds, and talking about voice user interfaces in really a different way than anybody else was at the time. But people were receptive to it. I think that I learned that when you show somebody something, it sparks something and it starts a conversation. And I think that this can be a very fruitful conversation. Early on in my research, another surprising finding was that voice user interfaces are being used by the blind and visually impaired. However, they're not replacing the technologies that the blind and visually impaired use to actually interface with the internet at work. And so I think that there could be a very interesting crossover between a technology that replaces the visual means by which we interface with the internet and word processing, and conversational interfaces that right now are mostly being used for sort of supplementary or recreational purposes. Sure. Well, so what most of the bigger companies are doing now is creating principles that really speak to the way conversation happens from person to person. And I think that this really makes sense because that's how we communicate using sound, and VUIs are technology that communicates information to us using sound. But I think that in any design pursuit, it's really important to try more than one approach. And I recognize that this might not be the only way, and that it's really important that we question when it comes to AI, whether or not there is another way. If we only imagine AI as being human-like, then we'll only design it as being human-like, and inevitably, artificial narrow intelligence will lead to artificial general intelligence, will lead to artificial super intelligence, and humans will be less useful than they are now. And so I wanted to sort of begin to think about ways that AI, and in particular VUIs, can function not just as an assistant that completes tasks for us or removes the need to complete tasks at all, but a tool that makes tasks more efficient, maybe even more delightful. Well, getting started, I think a good rule of thumb is always to be aware of what's happening around you. But I would urge other designers to stay open-minded in this field. I think that, you know, while there is a lot of research out there, it's important to do your own research. And the exciting thing about this medium is that it's easy to do your own research. Whether or not you're a developer or a coder, you know, voice is extremely accessible because of Wizard of Oz testing. All you need is a piece of foam core to separate yourself from a user, and suddenly you have a prototype. The only way to know whether or not something is going to work, even something crazy, is to try it. And so I would encourage other designers to try crazy things because it's easy and you come away with really a new understanding of the medium. Boy, I hope I don't forget anybody. But well, firstly, my advisors through my thesis Tim Malley, Charlie Cannon, Ellie Menger, and Ryan Bardsley were really crucial to my process. All of them, you know, ranging in knowledge of what VUIs do, from never having worked with one before to working with one every day. I think it was really great to have all of their perspectives in my project and all of the references and resources that they clued me into were essential to, like, you know, bringing it to its full potential. So it's really important to have people to talk to, I think, when you're exploring sort of a foreign subject matter. And there were many, many moments within this project where I felt like I'm completely lost. And yet I think that with the support of my professors and my classmates, I think that I created something meaningful. So I think that VUIs and chatbots are a really exciting space to be working in because they are really one of the first spaces where universal design is expressing itself digitally. You know, we have websites that have been coded to be conducive to screen reader usage and, you know, physical tools that help handicapped people to operate computers. But really, these are add-ons to a system that's been designed essentially for sighted, able-bodied people. And I think that VUIs are really one of the first places in technology, digital technology, where both disabled and abled people are being included from the first stages of design.